and thanks for joining me. I'm Naomi from Omi Industries, and I'm going to be going over some more ways you can use the Cascading Register. If you need a refresher on shift registers or how the Cascading Register works, go back and watch the first part of this series. This first patch is inspired by Rob Hordyke, and specifically his Rungler circuit, made famous by the Benjulin. There have been many adaptations of his design, each with their own take on the basic configuration. I'll be patching up my own interpretation of this iconic design using a few basic modules. However, this works with a wide range of modules, so feel free to substitute your own as needed. Basically, how a Rungler patch works is you have two oscillators, A and B, and a shift register. Oscillator A's pulse output clocks the shift register, while oscillator B's pulse output provides data to the shift register. The last three digital outputs from the shift register pass into a simple digital-to-analog converter and are turned into stepped voltages, which Hordyke describes as a stepped havoc wave. This stepped CV is routed back into both the clock and data oscillators, modulating their frequency and creating a feedback loop. The two oscillators also cross-modulate each other, creating a second feedback loop. In addition to the shift register and two oscillators, you generally get a filter to sculpt the timbre of the chaos. The Rungler output also modulates the frequency of this filter. Now, in Benjulin-based designs, the two oscillators' triangle waves pass into a comparator, creating a pulse waveform based on the relationship between the two oscillators. In the patch I'm going to show you, I'm just running the oscillator's output straight into the filter. So it's not the same as a Benjulin, but that's not really what I'm trying to do. All right, so now we're going to start going over how to set up a Rungler patch. So I'm going to be using maths as my two oscillators. I'm going to take the end of rise output and clock the cascading register. And then I'm going to take channel 4 and take the end of cycle to provide data. Then let's listen to those two outputs. I'm using the QPOS as the filter. And let's take CV1 into the both input of channel 1 and CV2 into the both input on channel 4. And then let's take channel 4's variable output into channel 1's rise CV input. And we'll take the variable output of channel 1 into the fall input on channel 4. I have found that generally you want, if you're cross-modulating the two channels on maths, one channel to modulate the rise and the other the fall. I've just found that this is a good way to do it. And then we're going to take CV3 and we're going to modulate the frequency of the filter. It's really essential that you have variable control over the amplitude of the signals modulating each other in a Rungler-style patch, because just little small changes lead to huge differences in the sound and pattern and variation within the patch. One great thing about the cascading register is that's the seed input. So if the Rungler patch ever gets stuck, which sometimes it does like this, you can just enter new data into the data stream. So now this is modular. We can go from this basic framework and start having fun. So I'm going to be using the R2RAR. The R2RAR is a bit like the circuits in CV1 and CV2 outputs on the cascading register, except for you can patch external signals into the digital to analog converter. One great thing about that is you can take different signals from the three groups that are already there, and then combine them in different ways to get different CV outputs that are related but different. And let's take the internal clock oscillator out into the R2R just for fun. And we'll take that output into the resonance of the filter. We've been listening to the bandpass output of the QPAS, but let's bring in some of those other outputs. So we have a low pass, a high pass, and the smart pass. I like the bandpass filter best, so let's just use that. And then we can do things like we can take other gate outputs and ping the filter to add some more percussion. Now you could just go from here and you could do anything else that you have a module of. You could patch the waveforms before the filter into a wave folder or a wave shaper to give them a little bit more harmonic character. You could put reverb after the filter. You could do just about anything you want to do. So this is just kind of a basic way to set up a Rungler patch and some of the sounds you might get from it. So I'll just let it play for a little bit and adjust the controls. For this next example, I'm going to show off some ways to use the cascading register with rhythmically centered patches. I'm not actually going to use the cascading register's CV outputs to affect any of the timbral parameters in this patch, and instead opt for using the gates to show off their modulation potential. I'm clocking the cascading register from the QCD, as well as triggering three drum sounds from the other channels. I'm also triggering a few drum sounds with the gate outputs from the cascading register. Then I'm running all those drums into the quad mute, and we can bring those in one at a time. Now let's take the CV outputs from the cascading register to vary the division or multiplication of the clock triggering these drum sounds. As I mentioned before, I'm taking the gate outputs to modulate different parameters on the back-in and BIA. for this third patch, I'm going to show off a bit of how you can use the Cascading Register for use with video synthesis. It's a great source of video noise, which you can see in the background, or to downsample video, which we're going to be looking into today. So here's an overview of the patch we're going to be looking at. I have a video signal coming to the cadet sync input and the video input, and then that's going into the cadet hard key generator. The video passes from the hard key generator into the data input on the Cascading Register. I found using a hard keyer before going into the Cascading Register both squares up the video to something closer to a gate signal the module expects, and also gives you more control over the final product by varying the threshold of the video signal. I'm also taking the square wave from the Castle Clock VCO and clocking the Cascading Register. And then I run those three CV outputs into shutter. I patch the VCO and hard key outputs into the shutter just so we could see what's going on. From shutter, then the three signals pass into the triple function generator and the RGB encoder before being sent to an outboard mixer and then a capture card. So here we have the video that I'm using for the patch. I used a skateboard video, so there's lots of motion you can clearly visualize. And here are those signals from the hard key generator and the VCO. Now here we have the downsampled multicolored noise the Cascading Register is great at delivering. I can play with the VCO's frequency, and as well the threshold on the hard key generator. One thing to keep in mind is internal clock VCO can introduce a little bit of noise into the system if it's being modulated at video rates. This only happens when the signal going into the oscillator goes above 5 volts, so you can either turn down CV3 output level or the frequency knob on the internal clock oscillator. Another option is simply to plug a dummy cable into the CV input, which breaks the normalization. I'm using a video signal and a VCO, but feel free to experiment with other clock and data sources. Another thing to keep in mind is that the Cascading Register can be clocked up to about 6 MHz, but the data input doesn't take signals that fast, so running too fast of a signal into the data input, the module might not track it. Also, play around with creating feedback loops with the CV or gate outputs from the Cascading Register to get more complex and noisy signals. Well, that's all for today. I'm Naomi from Omi Industries, and I wish you happy patching.